Recording live from the Hoban Law Group here in Denver, Colorado, I'm your host, Eric Singular. Welcome to the Hoban Minute.
Today, we're talking about using all parts of the industrial hemp plant, and we are joined by the CEO of HempFlax, Mark Reinders. Mark, thank you for being here with us today.
Yeah, thank you for your invitation. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, I've really been looking forward to this conversation for a number of reasons, but the largest of which is that as the industrial hemp industry here in the United States develops, we have an enormous amount to learn from folks like yourself, folks who have been operating in this space over in Europe for the last couple of decades. And so there's really just, there's a huge learning curve, I'm sure, as you become aware of, with American farmers, American hemp processors. There's this real gap in knowledge, and we've had to rely heavily on folks like yourself, whether it's from production techniques, processing techniques, or you know, even looking at what products can be made out of hemp. And of course, you know, what we really wanted to dive into today is this idea of the whole plant. So Mark, if you would, just give us some background on HempFlax and really, you know, where you stand philosophically on why it's so valuable and important to use all of the different components of the industrial hemp plant.
Oh, yes, I can. It's exactly right what you said about the learning curve. I always say we are going through the learning curve for the last 27 years now. We founded in 1994 by cannabis entrepreneur Ben Dronkers, well known in the industry. And actually, the reason he founded HempFlax was to prove to all the people he spoke to that they were wrong, that hemp couldn't be an industrial crop anymore in the future. We need to go back in time where we understand that the prohibition was lost on cannabis, that also included the industrial hemp as well. So let's say from the late 50s, early 60s, there was no industrial hemp growing anymore. So in those 40, 50 years that there was no industrial hemp, there was no development on harvesting technology, no development on processing technology, and there were no markets anymore. And the market has shifted more towards using synthetic fibers rather than industrial hemp fibers. So all these kind of things needed to be reintroduced and developed. And there was no industry at that moment left that could be an example of what we could learn from. So it was a real pioneering experience. In the early 90s, we're happy that we were able to show hemp and needed to change legislations whereby industrial hemp got excluded from the opium law. That was step one. By the time we managed to do that, we need to find out which varieties do best where and what kind of sowing technologies you need and what depth and what sowing time. So it was a lot of pioneering and a growing path. And then you need to harvest it. And in the end, you were happy you got some straw. And then the real problem starts, and you need to process it. And in order to process it, we had to develop technology. So we started using an old flax factory as a starting point. But after 2 years, it turned out that flax technology doesn't meet the criteria for processing hemp. So we sold off that facility again and decided to build a complete new factory, completely dedicated to hemp in 98. And then finally, we had a fiber. And then you had to develop markets as well. So it was a long, long pioneering road. First, you start focusing on fiber, but then you find out that with only fibers, you are not earning enough money to pay off all the cost of growing and harvesting and all the investments. And as a byproduct of the fiber production, if you like it or not, you will have shies, and it's the booty core of the stalk. And there was a need and urgency to develop a market for the shies as well. And we found in animal bedding, we found a good market at that time. And you have to realize as well that CBD nobody knew about, and there was no CBD at all. So the pure sole reason we have started HempFlax was for the fiber. And then we needed to capitalize on the byproducts in order to become profitable. And in 2014, we did our first moves in CBD business, actually by just harvesting the leaves and the flowers for clients. And then later on, we also started extracting ourselves the leaves from the hemp crop into extracts. And we start blending the extract into mix. Finally, we start packing and encapsulating the premixes as well. So now, today, where we stand, we have a fully integrated company from the seed to shelf. And if you speak about animal bedding, we have brands in retail. About CBD, we go to ready-to-consume products. And even for the fiber that's being processed in our own hemp insulation factory that we acquired last year into ready-to-use insulation beds for housing. So also there you have the whole value chain. And it's our true belief that it would be a pity to only use one part of the hemp crop from a crop that is giving us so much opportunities, so much possibilities, to only use one part. That will be a waste of the opportunity. So we do believe that you can't grow hemp for CBD only. It's just too expensive to do that. And you can't grow hemp for fiber only. So that's the reason we are totally vertically integrated and we capitalize on all the revenue streams crop is giving us. Even the dust from the factory is being sold as a rose breeding growing medium in the horticultural industry and is being exported even to South Korea for the rose breeding industry. So nothing gets lost in the factory.
No waste. And I really appreciate that you said that this has been a 27-year learning curve. And of course it has, because this is a, as you mentioned, a plant and a crop that had been essentially not part of our world for so many decades, and that it didn't really have a chance to go through the same industrialization cycle that other crops went through. It's fascinating to compare everything that you're saying about the development of HempFlax and this business with what we've seen here in the United States. Of course, CBD and cannabinoid extraction was the driving force here over the last 5 years, I'd say, since the crop was re-legalized here in the U.S. But I'm really interested in what you were saying about animal bedding, because this is exactly what we're seeing here as far as kind of the most immediate use of hemp fiber. It doesn't require, it seems, like an enormous amount of processing, nearly not as much as getting to some kind of textile grade material. You know, I think there's so much to learn as far as how the industry develops here in the U.S. from everything that you all learned doing this back in the 90s and the early 2000s. I want to talk a little bit about these end markets that you ultimately and HempFlax ultimately was able to work within, because this is another place where we're just on the cusp of here in the United States. I know that the one of the things that HempFlax does is construction and building materials, which is fascinating. As if I'm not mistaken, even your building is made out of hempcrete. And so I'd like to, you know, talk a little bit more about that use. I'd love to talk about the use in automotive manufacturing. It seems like that's another place where you've been successful in using hemp as a bioplastic material. So give us a sense of, you know, maybe what we can look forward to here in the U.S. as this supply chain and this market's developed, based on how you were able to incorporate those short fibers from hemp into the building materials and automotive sectors.
Okay, that's also a story that comes with the development, of course. It's not that we from day one had products for all those markets. Not at all. It actually, we started with fibers and we had the choice. And what you said as well, the animal bedding is not a very high-tech market. As long as you have a packing machine to pack the choice and press compressed bales. And you have a cleaning line to clean the shives, to de-dust it and grade it to the right size. You know, you have a product. It's more easy than making particle boards or hempcrete building blocks, prefabricated walls. It's all possible with hemp shives, but it needs more know-how and technology. So animal bedding was a relatively low barrier to enter the market. And it's good value. You can easily compete with other bedding materials as hemp. Shives are outperforming other bedding materials like wood shavings or sawdust because our material is virtually dust-free. And a lot of small pets do have lung problems and allergies towards dust and materials. And hemp, because of the high quality, it's a very premium high-end bedding material also for horses, especially high-end race horses. Those companies do love to use hemp shives. Also, because of the absorption capacity, hemp absorbs 5-6 times its own weight thanks to the natural structure of the shive. So that's why it makes perfect material for bedding. And for the fiber, you know, there are different grades. The lowest grade fiber is just raw decorticated fiber. You need the lowest amount of equipment to come to this decortication state. We call it paper grade fiber. And the paper grade fiber could be supplied to cellulose pulping companies that makes pulp for paper industry. Actually, the first years of the history of HempFlax, we supplied paper grade fiber for pulping. And those pulps were used for high-end papers like banknotes, fallible contract document paper, but also cigarette paper. So sometimes we made the joke that at the end of the day, you will smoke it anyway. But a lot of our hemp fiber disappeared in the cigarette paper. But then you're developing your company, you're developing new technologies, you become able to refine the fiber and clean the fiber to higher purities. And then you come to a level that's called insulation-grade fiber. So you can make insulation beds for it for construction and housing, which is potentially a massive market. Because everybody in the market does understand the need for insulating your house. By insulating your house, you obtain energy saving. And using less energy is less fossil fuel being used and less CO2 emitted. Actually, everybody understands that. But not much people do understand that producing a lot of insulation materials itself causing a lot of CO2 emissions. For example, to produce glass fiber insulation, you need 10 times more energy compared to hemp fiber insulation. Where glass fiber insulation is emitting, on rock wool insulation as well, emitting up to 200 kilograms of CO2 per cubic meter in the production phase, where hemp is emitting only 40 up to 60 kilograms a cubic meter, if you take logistics, harvesting, production into account. But if you also take into account the CO2 fixation of the crop during growing, we have a negative footprint. So that means that hemp insulation is fixing about 40 kilograms of CO2 for a long time. And that will be great in the upcoming carbon-based economy because we have to reduce CO2. Hemp can be playing a very pivotal role in obtaining that that CO2 emission goals. And then, of course, you develop and you come up with new equipment and you purify and clean the fiber even better. And then you come up in the quality of fiber that's usable for the automotive industry. And that's a higher quality fiber, so then logically a higher price. And there we replace glass fiber in interior parts, where normal interior parts, you like a dashboard, a door panel, your mid console, are polypropylene or polyurethane based. Plastics with a glass fiber reinforcement. And the glass fiber can be replaced with hemp fiber, whereby you obtain the same stiffness of the part with 30% weight reduction. So weight reduction is so important in the automotive industry because if your fuel consumption goes down or your action radius, if you drive an electrical car, goes up, if the car had less weight. And then the final step is if you purify the fiber even further, you can even go to textile-grade fiber. And textile-grade fiber, there we can replace cotton. Mm. And if you look at cotton, the only natural thing about cotton, it's growing from a plant, and that's it. If you look at the water use, pesticide use, land use, cotton is not such a sustainable fiber as we think it is. Hemp can be very good replacement for that. So, you know, you start with a very low-grade fiber and you develop during the years and you're getting more and more experience. And in the end, you have high-quality fiber. I would advise everybody in the U.S. not try to do everything at once. Sometimes I get requests if I can supply equipment for a project, and that they want to have a decortication unit, they want to have harvesters, they want to have a hemp insulation line, a building block, hempcrete block making line, they want a hemp oil press, they want a CO2 extractor, they want to do everything at once. And I would say don't do that, because then you have so many projects going on at the same time. It's not manageable anymore, and you're lacking the experience. And getting experience in the hemp industry is just by doing. Get a few rounds of crops and get experience, start with decortication, start with a lower grade fiber. If that goes well, build up your market steadily. Add extra equipment to add more value, but really take your time for doing that.
Now for all of our listeners here in the U.S. who are trying to develop some aspect of the hemp supply chain, heed that advice. You know, that's coming from somebody and from a group that has been doing this for decades. And, you know, your story behind how you developed all of these markets and uses is really a tale and a story that we need to acknowledge here in the U.S., because you're absolutely right with certain groups who just want to try to do everything. And you really have to build one core competency before you can continue on to the next thing. And you know, I do think there's so much value in this understanding that, you know, getting to a textile grade fiber, which a lot of folks here in the U.S. are very interested in, particularly in the southern U.S. where the majority of cotton growers are, they're extremely interested in that. But you know, as you are saying, it's a long road. It's a lot of learning. And, you know, we barely have 1 or 2 years of actually growing industrial hemp in some of those regions. So it's going to take time and there's going to be a lot of failure along the way, but that's how we learn. I do want to highlight that some of the automotive manufacturers that I believe you've worked with include Bugatti and Porsche. So, yes. I mean, we're talking very high-end automotive manufacturers who are working with this material. And that should provide a lot of hope for folks here in the U.S., particularly with a strong automotive industry based kind of in the Midwest and the Michigan area. Your comments about carbon sequestration and the carbon markets, this is, you know, when I was at the NOCO event this past year here in Denver, this is where the conversation in the United States is just almost entirely focused upon in terms of why this crop and plant can be so beneficial. And I just want to ask a couple of questions to you while we have you on the line, because I know that some of the more agricultural, agronomic folks listening will be interested in your knowledge on this. But in your experience, you know, what factors influence the carbon sequestration of hemp? In other words, does it vary depending on the variety? Does it vary depending on the end use of the crop? Does it vary depending on the planting and harvesting methods? These are the kinds of questions that we simply don't have the answers to, and we're trying to figure out. So I'm interested if you could shed a little bit of light on some of those points.
Yeah, I can. Of course, I do not believe there's much difference between carbon dioxide uptake between the different varieties of hemp. We say roughly 1 kilogram of dry mass of industrial hemp took 1.5 kilogram of carbon dioxide. It's very reasonable to believe that's the same over the variety. But what the crop takes from the air during the growing season, what you leave of that offtake at the air, what's being left over after all the process to the end product, that depends a lot on how you do it. For example, if I take our company as an example, we do grow in a maximum radius of 50 kilometers around our factory in the Netherlands. And sorry, you're still calculating kilometers, so you do the math to go back to miles, but we stay relatively close to the factories because the raw material straw is quite a lot of volume you harvest. You know, in our company, we do about 50,000 straw bales a year in total in our company. So you don't want to drag them around over long distances of the road. On the other hand, as well, how is your production process organized? How energy efficient is your production process? If we look at the energy consumption we have today per metric ton produced, processed, it's only a quarter of what it was 20 years ago because our machines became so much more efficient and we have such higher throughput an hour compared to what we had in the past, so that your energy use per metric ton input goes down tremendously. And on top of that, I'm very happy to and pleased to inform you that we are going to install on a factory in the Netherlands 1.9 megawatt of solar panels. So our Dutch facility will be solar energy run starting end of this year. And on top of that, we are even looking at our logistics of the end products, because we're selling our products, let's say, roughly 600-700 kilometers around our factory is our marketing area. And we do the same from Romania, which actually is about 1,600 kilometers away from the Dutch facility. Also there, we grow close to the facility and we sell 600-700 kilometers around our facility. So we get some total European coverage, like a telephone network, putting all, you know, smaller facilities, but in the middle of the markets where you need to be. Even the logistics we're going to use to send our customers, we are investing in a hydrogen truck. Early next year, when they come to the market, we will be the first having a hydrogen truck to transport our goods to our clients with hydrogen instead of diesel. And also in our farming operation, we're looking at possibilities of replacing our diesel tractors by hydrogen tractors. They're not really on the market yet. There are some prototypes that's coming up, but we're following that. And so all the little steps, each single step in a supply chain, you need to look very closely and think for yourself, okay, how can I do this better? How can I use less fossil fuel? Hemp grows carbon negative. But if you emit a lot of carbon during your operation, during your supply chain, your net result is not as good as you wish to be. So look very critical at your supply chain.
Mm. Well, Mark, it's so encouraging to hear about the growth of HempFlax and to hear about all of the sustainability initiatives that you're taking and the sustainable growth. You know, you raised a point that is so valuable, and that is a point of patience, which I think here in the U.S. hemp industry, we're struggling to grapple with. We believe so wholeheartedly in the potential of this plant. We see groups like yourself who have had so much success and have really done in tremendous work in bringing this plant back and figuring out all of this knowledge about how to harvest it, how to grow it, how to produce it, process it, that was simply lost. And so, you know, there's just this beautiful lesson in what you're saying, which is it takes time. And I think that's something we just have to kind of wrap our heads around. But before I let you go, I know recently one of the utilizations that HempFlax was using for their fiber was a hemp chair. And I'm just interested, here in the next 12 to 24 months, can you give us a sneak peek here on the Hoban Minute about some potential other uses that HempFlax is exploring for other products that might be interesting?
Oh, I think I refueled already one of those. We are looking very closely at textiles. We have some smaller projects already commercialized, but it's relatively small scale. We see potentially massive opportunities in textile. You know, the world population will continue to grow. So two things will be important is, of course, food security, supply food. Now, we all know that hemp could be a food as well, is a food, and the hemp seeds very good hemp oil, you can press them in from a press gate, you can make proteins. Even in other parts of the hemp, there's quite a lot of proteins to be found. So we're looking at that as well, because as a society, we have to make a little shift towards a more plant-based protein diet instead of animal-based protein diet. And I think that's possible, and hemp can play a pivotal role in that. But also the fibers itself, I think we can do much more in textiles than we do now today.
Well, just as it says right there on the HempFlax website, the industrial applications of hemp are endless. Mark, I thank you so much for your time today. For any of our listeners who want to learn more about HempFlax, you can visit their website at hempflax.com. And Mark, until next time, thank you for shedding all of your perspective and insight here with us today on the Hoban Minute.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you for having me on the show today.
Thank you for listening to this episode of the Hoban Minute. If you have any ideas for episode topics or guests, we would like to hear from you. Reach out to us at media@hoban.law and stay tuned for more on the Hoban Minute.